Good luck. The first live show of season 15. Woo! Woo!
Let's do it. Do we have an ETA on Judges and Ryan?
I think it's on schedule for Judges and Ryan.
Better be, we're live at 5.
Ready on the floor? Yeah.
15, 14, 13.
Stand by, eh? Bit quiet, please. About to go on air.
11, 10, 9.
Stand by, VOM
eight,
music.
7, 6.
In 5.
4.
Ready?
Transition.
I am.
3, 2, 1.
11.
Transition music.
Mark.
I've tried the traditional way to get in the music industry from the time I was 7 years old.
I had made some demos, I had sent some stuff out, I got no response.
We didn't have money to make a demo.
It was definitely the struggling artist syndrome.
I was just looking for that big break.
My friend heard about some audition. It was some kind of singing show. At that time, they had like, I can't remember what the show was called, but it was like pop something.
The origins of American Idol started in the UK with Pop Idol.
The beauty of the format is its simplicity. It's really that Cinderella story of a kid from nowhere with huge talent who, through the process of taking part in Idol, has a real shot of having a singing career and changing their life.
Prior to 2002, the music industry is a traditional industry. It's one where the record labels are the ones who are creating these pop stars who fit into certain kinds of formulas. Some people call them cookie cutter artists. And as audiences, we respond to what record labels have given us.
Now, I didn't particularly like that because you were beholden to the industry. Pop Idol allowed me to bypass all those rules and all those gatekeepers and go straight to the public.
The first season was a huge success in the UK.
It was so successful, I thought that Pop Idol had the potential to work in many different countries. And from an English point of view, if you haven't made it in America, then you really haven't made it at all.
And these two Simons pitch to the networks in the US. One's a record exec, one's a manager. Nobody knows who they are.
Everyone kept saying to me, a music show is not going to work on American TV. And I said, well, it's not quite a music show. It's obviously part of it.
There certainly wasn't any music competitions on the air. The only thing was Star Search, and that was years ago.
Back in those days, broadcast networks were in a state of panic about how they were going to stand the onslaught of cable. Survivor opened up the gauntlet of what hit TV could be. Who Wants to Be a Millionaire was a part of that. So the search for cheap, non-scripted primetime programming was on.
When we finally got the green light from Fox, which was about middle of February of 2002, we had to start filming in April.
They had a bunch of VHS tapes, and they said, this is the British version of the show. We want the American version of this.
And we watched the show, and I'm going, okay, I don't know if this is gonna work.
We were doing auditions for Judges. And honestly, nobody had any idea what they were doing. So I called Randy Jackson. Randy was in the music business. He was A&R executive at MCA at the time.
And he said, hey, man, I think you might want to be a judge on this show or something. I go, I don't know if it's going to work, because usually music shows on TV are very corny.
We wanted someone that had been a pop star. And Paul was charming and funny. And we didn't know that blend would work, but it worked fantastically.
Paula was the choreographer as well. She was really, really good at spotting talent.
I saw two episodes of Pop Idol where Simon Cowell annihilated some contestants with full vim and vigor, like no shame.
I do not think if you were to win this competition as Pop Idol that we have done our job properly, because I think there's better people than you.
One thing we knew was that we had to have Simon Cowell imported. He was clearly the thing sending it over the moon.
Because I'd had such a negative reaction from all the networks, I wasn't sure what it was going to be like working in America.
He quit a week before we were supposed to film.
And Kenny Warwick said to me, they really, really are going to back this show, Simon.
I promise you, I'll have you on the front of Time magazine inside 3 months.
We were working between the Price is Right and the Family Feud offices.
At the beginning, it was a shoestring budget. The production value was not great at all.
We were just a little summer show, so everyone's expectations were pretty low.
The reason there were two hosts for the first season was because they had two guys in the UK that did it, and they wanted to do the same thing here. I was a 25-year-old kid doing radio and a couple little things on television. I was so excited to get the opportunity to host a primetime show. Whether people watched it or not, it was a great gig.
Hi, I'm Ryan Seacrest.
And I'm Brian Dunkelman.
We're with the new Fox series, American Idol, here in LA, kicking off the biggest music talent search in history. Here
we go. We didn't know what to expect. Paul and I were sitting there, the first two contestants in.
When it's cold outside, I've got the middle of May. Well,
What is this? Where are we? What the hell is this show? What's going on?
My girl.
Steven, stop. That was terrible. I mean, seriously terrible.
My girl. I remember after the second kid in, we took a break because, like, hang on. This is insanity.
If you want to achieve what you want to achieve, you will not do it with your voice.
I thought I was doing people a service by saying to someone, you can't sing, so go and do something which you're good at.
Don't look at me like that.
All a freak now.
I quit 8 times the first day.
This guy, he can have 100,000 lessons. He cannot sing.
I disagree. I don't think anyone should be told they can't do anything, no matter what.
Yeah, but Paula, he's 18 years old. He's having an opportunity to sit in front of three people from the
Simon,
music.
Simon, I understand what you're saying, but I disagree with what
no,
you're
I think
saying.
You're patronizing him.
I'm not patronizing him at all.
I do.
It was real. It was genuine. There was no staged arguments.
I just was shocked that Simon could really be as rude as he was. That's been around in Hollywood forever. It's just that in America, people say it behind your back, not in front of your face.
Back then, no one was turning up for auditions. I remember in Seattle running around a mall, handing out flyers, begging people to come because no one had heard of it, no one knew what it was.
In order to be seen by anyone, it took hours. And people were just singing at the top of their lungs. And I thought, I don't want to be here. I almost got out of line.
Okay.
So we've done all these auditions. We've seen some crazy, funny, wild people. We're at like some VFW hall in Dallas.
The day the music died.
It just did. We were having a terrible day. And I'm thinking, God, what am I doing this for? They're all useless.
Hello?
Goodbye.
And the show's gonna be a disaster at the end.
This is unique. I like this. Is that a skirt? This.
No, I mean, it used to be my pants though, and I made it.
Literally, my place in LA and it just burned down. I'm out of money. Everything's gone. I lived in my car for 3 days. I just thought, if this pays my bills, it's worth it, you know, because I had nothing at that point.
She tried to make it as a singer in Los Angeles, and she'd gone back to Dallas and worked in a bar.
I was really kind of intimidated to walk into the room, and all these girls and guys walking out in tears, like, what's happening in this room?
Ready? Can we have Brian be back, please?
Ready, just in case.
All righty, should I just start?
Hello, Kelly.
Hello. Hello. My love has come along, my Lord.
When Kelly came in, I knew, and I think we all knew, we got a winner.
And life is like a song.
I could not believe the power that comes from her voice. That girl had amazing pipes.
Skies above are blue.
She couldn't be anybody else but the girl from Texas that loves to just flat foot sing.
A dream that I can call my own. Okay, the next song.
The show was cheesy, but we watched the next week and the next week.
It was like, oh, Farm Girl from Oklahoma. We like this.
Carrie Underwood!
That's when I realized how big of a deal American Idol was gonna be.
Greatest love of all.
When American Idol debuted, we were still healing from 9/11. And when you're going through the strife and loss, you want to hang on to something that gives hope.
Love of all inside of me.
The economy was not doing well. We were going to war. And here comes the show full of kids singing their parents' songs, looking to get a break and to make it.
And you had families coming together, listening to a song that the grandparents knew, that the parents knew, and now the kid is being introduced at the same time. In
love. I think that it was an ambitious thing because I don't think you're that kind of singer. I don't think you're that good. So I was disappointed. I was.
Simon, come on.
No, I'm serious. I was disappointed.
The head of Fox at that time said, OK, this is what we want you to do. Lose Simon Cowell because his personality is far too acerbic for the American public, and we want you never to show a bad audition because we only celebrate the success in America. And we thought, well, what? Hang on, you've just described a different show.
The problem I have is that you don't look like an American Idol.
Say that's all.
Well, unfortunately, the record-buying audience around the world.
Simon Cowell did expose those looksist and ageist realities of the music industry.
Simon, what exactly is the look of an American Idol? Is she just singing Aretha Franklin song? Does Aretha look like an American Idol?
I do not believe that if Aretha Franklin entered this competition, she would win it now.
Are you kidding me?
I don't.
Cowell and I, we had beef over that because you can't say to someone, you don't look like an American Idol. We don't know what that is.
Tomorrow, the way you look, the way you sing, I thought it was one of the best we've seen today. Amazing.
To be honest with you, all I was interested in, who was going to win, sign it to the record label. That's why the show was designed in the first place. You know, it wasn't for me to be a loudmouth on a panel. It was to steer the show in a way that can find an artist we want to sign and sell as many records as possible.
Christine, if I was judging a beauty competition, you'd win. But with judging a singing competition, it wasn't good enough. It was the wrong choice of song for you. You're out of your league in this. Sorry.
Thank you.
The whole premise of Idol is we're saying to the public, here, you tell me what you like. I've chosen some talent here, but you tell me who's the best, and you tell me by voting.
This is the first of our shows where you have the power to choose who you'd like to continue in the competition and whose dream ends here.
There's no iTunes. There's no iPhones. This was the high technology. Pick up your phone and dial as many times as you can.
Jim Varela.
Yes! The first night we did the voting, we got 2 million votes. We thought 100,000 would be amazing. 200, we didn't know.
I remember what Simon said last night. He said something bad about Jim. Simon, didn't you? What did
yes.
you say?
I said, if Jim wins this competition, I think we failed.
America, you voted for AJ Gill.
When people were able to start voting themselves, Americans started voting against Simon Cowell. They started voting against his picks.
Two losers have been voted through for one reason and one reason only. It is the sympathy vote. They are losers and they do not deserve to be in this competition.
But you don't have to call them losers.
No, I'm going to tell you something. Being cavalier,
you don't have to call them losers.
Being cavalier in judging effort. America is about celebrating the effort of
the Oh, don't give me that American rubbish, Paula.
It's true, Simon.
That is rubbish.
My big thing, though, is always like, if you can't handle Simon Cowell, then you're screwed in this industry. Yeah, he's nothing. He was just being honest, and a lot of times I agreed. You can't handle that level of criticism. It gets worse.
Some contestants would come in, and they would have this star presence. I remember Justin Guarini just walked in the door, and everyone was like, that guy's a star.
You have something which we're talking about throughout in this competition.
Okay.
And we're asked this all the time, what is it? Well, it's very simple, it's you.
And other contestants would come in and they would become stars over the course of the show.
Kelly, I remember more for goofing around than having a great first audition.
I honestly don't know what to say. You have a good voice, but I couldn't remember you from the previous rounds.
So I was like, oh, well, can't hear that enough. Woo!
Look at us.
The very first time I heard Kelly Clarkson sing, I thought she was okay. Just okay. But when we had the top 10, she just grew week on week on week. And anything that she was challenged with, she just shone and shone.
Oh, baby, what's your
It was only when we got to the middle stages where she really brought it for the first time, and it was like, my God, I wasn't expecting that.
And then she did this triple octave jump. And the whole studio went, what have we got here?
I remember seeing Kelly on the first season of Idol and like, oh my gosh, there's some really good singers on this show.
America is not known for nice singers, it is known for great singers, and you are one of them. Congratulations.
Fox was third or fourth place in 2002. Those first ratings coming in were beyond our wildest expectations.
I remember when the first season started, I'd never seen anything like it, and getting quickly addicted.
I got a call from one of my aunties. She was like, you gotta turn it on, Fox. After that, I said, I'm gonna try it.
Me and all of my band members watched together, and our collective consensus was the show was cheesy. But we watched the next week and the next week.
American Idol grew and grew from 9 million viewers to 23 million viewers just in the first season.
The first season, and I mean this respectfully, was put together with prayers and chewing gum.
We had to flip coins for songs because no one would approve their songs to be sung on a talent show.
Literally, somebody hit the play button on a module, and, you know, we're singing along to tracks.
Everyone got laryngitis at one point, and then finally it hit me, too. I think I had to sing a Celine Dion song, which those aren't hard, so it's a good week to have it. Just how big it became, we had no idea. We were in a bubble.
It just got bigger and bigger and bigger.
We have, like, signs with our names on it. That's weird.
I think Justin's gonna win.
My money's on Kelly.
Justin.
Kelly.
I like Kelly. I think she's got the most raw, natural talent.
I think Kelly's gonna win.
I gotta give it to Kelly.
We knew the show was doing well, but that very first finale took us by surprise.
When we got down to that last day, it was extremely stressful because we have to rehearse and everyone's coming back. There's gonna be at least 30 million people watching this show, so we know the pressure's on and we've gotta deliver because people have made an investment in us.
EJ is still my choice. He's been my choice
Kelly.
Since the first show.
It's Kelly all the way.
I was obsessed with American Idol. I remember being at the very first finale in the audience.
When we go live and you don't know if something's gonna work, that's the biggest thrill.
The finale is like the combination of doing an award show, a music special, and a high school play.
Hi, okay, there we go.
There were so many different things that changed that day, including who was gonna sing when and what song.
We redid the entire rundown in about 20 minutes, told the contestants some new songs that we hadn't rehearsed.
Before they went out to sing It Takes Two, they were saying to me, sing it in my ear, sing it in my, I don't know that song. It takes two, baby. It takes two, baby. How about me and you? They're going, well, what happens after that? And I said, well, let's just get to the next commercial and then we'll find out.
Well.
At that time, we were told that we were gonna be cut to the local news, no matter where we were in the show, if we weren't done.
Well, all right, let's see what America has decided. This is it, Justin and Kelly.
Ryan had a sense of his place in history, and he said, David, no matter what happens, please try to make sure that I'm the one who says the winner of American Idol is...
The winner of American Idol 2002 is...
When it came down to the final pregnant pause, it was just so evident that this was her moment.
Kelly Clarkson.
People always ask me, like, what were you thinking when you won? I am not kidding. I broke down in tears backstage because I was so tired, I needed a nap. We were exhausted.
The first year of American Idol really set the standard. And Kelly Clarkson, I think she set the tone.
When Kelly won, that's when I realized how big of a deal American Idol was gonna be.
Honestly, we felt like proud parents. We'd raised the kid and sent the kid off into the world to go and conquer.
I remember watching Kelly Clarkson win, and all the contestants were around her, and everybody was clapping and just so excited. And I remember turning to my mom and going, I want to do that.
I was horrified to sing in front of Simon. What if I open my mouth and I'm way off?
Your heart just like drops to your feet.
I've seen people faint, throw up, pee on themselves, crazy stuff.
From Hollywood, the search for the American Idol 2002.
Kelly Clarkson.
Kelly Clarkson was a stroke of luck for American Idol because she established the legitimacy of the show and its format right out of the gate.
I saw where pop music had been, and in professional circles, if you're a talent contest winner, it's very hard to get that peer recognition. But Kelly was nominated for Grammys right from the get-go.
Breakaway sold over 11 million copies, like, and that's unheard of now.
By the time the season one finale, it was clear that this show was a hit, and that was our highest rated show, I think, in Fox's history at that point.
And we got a pickup immediately, which in our business is a really big deal.
The first year's auditions were modest, so we were planning something similar, maybe a little bigger.
We were totally unprepared for the number of people that started showing up.
Is our next American Idol among us today?
We knew that we needed to go to much larger venues.
This is where David Goffin had come up with a plan on his dry erase board. We're taking everything that we used to do in a hotel, and we're going to do it on a grand scale.
Me and my brother, we drove to Atlanta to audition. We didn't have a lot of gas money. We didn't have a lot of money to eat, but we were so determined.
Yeah, once you got all your paperwork and your tickets,
25,000 people auditioned when I was in Las Vegas.
I remember the first day I showed up for auditions, I didn't realize there's different stages before you get to the judges. But that was eye-opening and kind of scary.
Take a major stadium, put 12 tables across the field with 12 young producers, and they would have all of these kids in fives coming up to their table and sing for me, okay? Sing for me, sing for me.
And at the end of that first process, about 600 kids got through, and then Nigel and I would listen to every single one of them.
I come in the room, and there was Nigel. His first thing he said to me was, you don't look like an American Idol. I started singing, and he stopped me like 3 seconds in and was like, you're on to the next round.
From the EP round to the judge round, we get it down to 60, 70.
We only wanted the very best and obviously the very worst.
And anything in the middle could have been good, but it might also have been boring.
Cheap bass, cheap bass. Oh, baby, when she moves, she moves.
You just have to have the extremities.
In the early stages of auditioning, you're seeing total jokes getting through. So part of you is like, I'm hoping they brought me in because I'm good.
I was horrified to sing in front of Simon. What if I open my mouth and I'm way off? My judgment is way skewed.
That's the moment everybody waits for. You know you're on American Idol when you stand on that thing that says American Idol and it's behind you, all of that.
Jennifer Hudson from Chicago, Illinois. Yes, sir. Says that you just finished work on a Disney cruise ship?
Yes.
You're here because you think you're the next American Idol?
Yes, I do.
Okay, go for it.
All right. It's a heartache, it's a heartache when love is gone.
I believe people buy first what they believe. Do I believe you? Are you really authentic? Or are you just here for the show? And you just don't care, you'll be like whatever you think I want.
And if they don't cut it, we have to say, you're not ready, or your voice isn't strong enough yet.
We told everybody who didn't make it to follow us to the next city.
There was a girl that had to audition 3 times. By the time she got to us, we were like, where the hell you been? Why did it take so long for you, as good as you are?
My world is a better place because
that was Jordan Sparks.
I remember freaking out. I was like, no! I was so excited, and it was just such a cool moment. And I had that yellow ticket in my hand. I can't believe that I just made it.
Hi, friends, back live on American Idol.
The auditions are entertaining, but once we go live, that's the best part of the show. There's no safety net.
We'd go through our performances on Tuesday night and be up super late. The schedule starts just getting crammed.
They had us doing duets and group performances and learning all this choreography, and I was like, what? What is this?
There was nothing to keep the stress level down. It would be times like we all have our own little corners that we would go to just calm ourselves. Like I would sit in the stairwell.
People get sick, people get run down, people lose their minds. As much as you see people like, oh, I hate to see you go, that's bull crap. You're over there worried about you. Hope they don't call my name.
The shocking eliminations were sometimes heartbreaking.
The look on Chris Daughtry's face when he's eliminated?
Chris, you are going home tonight. The journey ends.
We were just as shocked when we got those results. But ultimately, our allegiance is to making sure that America's voice is being heard and that we let people go with dignity. That makes me sound like they're being euthanized.
No matter what show it was, I would always try to look at Charles Boyle, look at his eyes, try to look him in his face to see, yo, am I going home today, man? Like, tell the truth.
The most exciting final we had was Rupert and Clay, because you just couldn't call it. And it reminded me of a boxing fight. It was like 1-0, 1-all, 2-1, 2-2. I mean, it was so close. I think it was the closest final we ever had.
The winner of American Idol 2003 is...
We had 30-something million votes that night, and the difference between the votes was as small as 130,000.
Reuben Studdard!
Sometimes we wouldn't tell Ryan the results until he actually opened the envelope. Other times we needed to because something else was going to happen.
In a very digital, fast-moving, technological age, this show sometimes comes down to a piece of paper.
We have something called the results card. Then we type those up, and even to this day, I literally have a little bit of a panic that they're not right.
Every year for every finale, I stood in the wings and I've waited for Ryan to give that pause. And what happens with me is, oh my God, I've given him the wrong card. Oh my God, I have given him the wrong card. He's got the wrong name.
I do remember one night, for some reason, it was a 2-minute commercial break and we were all of a sudden back on the air. Welcome back to American Idol. I'm standing there, time for the results. You've been waiting for an hour for this. Dim the lights, here we go. Crap, I don't have the card. I thought, okay, let me ask a judge a question, and they're gonna cut tight shot to that judge.
Are people voting on performance or personality, Randy?
I think people must be clearly voting on personality.
Cut to Randy. Randy was talking. I sprinted off to the side, got the results card, came back, stood there, caught my breath, and said, thank you, Randy. And tonight leaving us is, and I don't think you would know on TV, but things like that would happen quite a bit on a live show.
When someone was voted out in the top 10, the judges could save them. So as they left the show, they'd be singing for their life.
Yeah, this is crazy wrong. I mean, we made a decision here to keep you on.
That Pacey Abrams save, I thought he was gonna vomit on the stage.
I've seen people faint, throw up, pee on themselves, crazy stuff.
We've still got to say adios to somebody. Let's get right to the results.
With Nigel, he'd have this horrible, devious way of executing the results.
Nigel is diabolical. He is a wonderful producer, but he likes to play with people's minds.
There was an incredible result which allowed me to play in all the tricks. There was Latoya London, Jennifer Hudson, and Fantasia. Without question, Jennifer Hudson and Fantasia were big fan favorites. And there were three other singers. The seventh was a guy called George. And as George came out in seventh place, we said, there are the three girls there. There are three people there. You're safe. So go and join the team that you believe are safe.
George Huff, everybody come on over.
George knew we were the top three. It was Fantasia, Latoya, and Jennifer. They called us the three divas.
George, I said step into the top group. You're in the wrong group. Please step over here because tonight, this is our bottom three. Fantasia, Jennifer Hudson, and Latoya London, America.
And you could see it on everyone's face, like, what just happened? What did they say?
The three divas, they split the votes.
I was laughing because those two girls are powerhouses. I remember hearing her sing and she killed. I thought I did good, but here we are.
Each and every one of us is like, oh my God, I'm going home. Oh my God, is it me? Am I going home? Who is it gonna be? All of those things is going through your head.
And that person is Jennifer Hudson. Fantasia, you are safe.
I remember everyone around me crying. I mean, everybody. It was a mess backstage.
When Jennifer Hudson went home, I thought, there's something wrong with these people in America that did not vote for this girl's performance.
America, don't forget, you have to vote for the talent. You gotta keep your favorites in the competition. You cannot let talent like this slip through the cracks.
I felt bad, but I knew she had that authentic thing. It just hadn't quite blossomed yet for everyone to see it.
I really don't know what to say, but I just wanna say thank y'all for letting me scream in y'all ears for a little while. I've enjoyed this journey, and I'm more than grateful, and I thank God for this opportunity, and I know there is something in store for me. But God bless you all.
I was like, I don't know when, I don't know how, but I will be back, and you will see me again. And 2 years later, there was Dreamgirls. When I was winning an Oscar at the Kodak Theater, I'm thinking, like, the Idol finale was here. That's the first thing that comes to my mind is American Idol.
Yeah, roll that paint on that wall. Oh.
Sing.
I'm gonna sing some Sam Cooke. I was, change is gonna come.
Great.
Everyone talks about the journey on Idol. Your Idol journey, their Idol journey, contestants' Idol journey.
They will not put you in the final group to be judged by the public.
Oh, that's not true. That's...
Taylor, you are safe. Congratulations.
That is the key to American Idol success. It's that America feels like they're seeing you progress and develop.
The huge fan base that I had called themselves the Soul Patrol. And it just was a light bulb that went off in my head. It's the television homes in America and the people that are voting that really make or break you.
The winner of American Idol Season 5 is Taylor Hicks!
I was always focused on how do you get an audience really engaged. The judges are very important, but they didn't make the decision. America did.
There are three people in front of me who know a lot about music, but haven't got a clue what's coming tonight.
By Season 2, we added text messaging.
1-866-IDOL-01.
I was called in early one day for a meeting, and they said, we're going to teach you how to text. You can teach America how to text, because that's how they're going to vote.
For singular customers who want to text in their support and don't know how, here's a little texting 101. You got to get out your phone at step one.
And I thought to myself, who in the world is going to spend the time taking the A and going A, B to the C?
My mom learned how to text through Idol and voting.
It was completely mind-boggling and revolutionary to allow the audience to vote on a primetime weekly show.
Pick up the phone at the end of the show and make sure your favorite wins this competition.
When Ryan says voting is open, the floodgates open. We were averaging 40 plus million votes a night.
Coming up in this half hour, have you watched American Idol? Apparently, it's just big. Getting crazy.
The winner is in this envelope.
Oh, Lord!
The holy grail on TV is engagement. American Idol made you lean forward, made you pay attention, instead of leaning back and passively watching.
They were passionate about the contestants because this is a entertainment show, but it's a sporting event as well.
The city is definitely in support of Fantasia.
Just like in sports, people were betting, the whole nation had a view on who should win.
The winner.
It was like finding out who won an Oscar times a million.
You had people from their couches blogging about what happened the night before on a television show.
Hey everyone, MTV News American Idol expert Jim Cantiello here with everything you need to know about this week's Idol in 60 seconds.
People made their own industries out of what was happening on American Idol, and I think that was probably the first time in television history that happened.
Our season, it was right when Idol on Fox.com was starting up.
Oh, I got four new ones.
They made us be on camera and watching it, and it was all horrible. Every comment was like, I hate you, she sucks, or I hope he gets kicked off, and we're all like, ha, ha, ha.
This is the real me. It really hurts a lot when people who don't know you say things that are not true.
Once the show was over, the conversation still continued until that next week's performance picked up. There will never be another show that is this consistently engaged with from an audience perspective.
American Idol dovetails right into the rise of all of these new technologies. The songs that you've just heard on the show, you can then purchase on the iTunes store, put it onto your iPod, and then go listen to it whenever you want.
All around me are familiar faces, worn out spaces, worn out faces.
Having a song of mine appear on the iTunes chart, it was surreal. The popularity of the song was validation that maybe I had stumbled onto something that was working for me.
These were pieces of music that the audience was buying because they became the perfect snapshot souvenir of that moment when that person performed on the show and made them feel a certain way.
You're voting for your favorite contestant all season long, but the hometown visit really allows you to be part of their story.
It's overwhelming to receive support from people that you've never even met.
Oh my God, I can't believe it!
Craziness ensues outside, too.
Oh my God.
I could see the momentum building back home. I had no clue that more people would gather at Lake Benson Park than actually live in my town. 30,000 folks showed up that day. What a feeling. Pretty incredible. One of the better days of my life.
I think that's the first inkling our contestants get of what their life might be like if they win.
After the show wrapped, the American Idol tour really brought things full circle. It really brought the audience from seeing that artist sing for the very first time through the process of being in the show right around to now they're here in my hometown performing for me. I voted for them. I'm connected with this person and I'm in. I'm a fan.
It was fun just for us to kind of get out of the sterile studio and actually get in front of a crowd and feel that immediate interaction.
The fans that are there for me all the time, the Glamberts, I met a lot of them face to face when I was on the Idol tour. I wouldn't have that core fan base without the show, I don't think. I wouldn't have that sense of family with them.
That's an age-old part of the music business, is the audience wanting that connection with the artist.
I hear still on a daily basis, I voted for you.
I have people that have been following me so long, I know them.
People just come up and just hug me, or, oh, I feel like I know you, or I feel like this, and I'm like, what is that? They would never do that to Beyonce. They would never do that to Alicia. I'm okay with it, but then I realized, I was like, I think it's because it's like our journey, and they've been a part of it, so they feel like, you know, they relate and connect in that way.
What do you think of this whole phenomenon that has become American Idol?
It's given us a couple of good singles here and there. It's a TV phenomenon. I really think it has to do more with television than with music.
When we started, there was a lot of resistance in the music industry. They sort of turned their nose up at Idol.
If they'd tried to offer my generation music by someone that had won a game show, it would have been hysterical.
The A&R community and a lot of the labels when we first started the show weren't fans of the show and weren't fans of ours. And people would say to us, what are you guys doing? This is wrong.
I don't agree with the premise of that show. You know, I'm a believer, you gotta get some scars and you gotta get some feel, and there's a certain path you gotta take in life with anything you do. You know, before you own the garage, you gotta learn how to sweep the floors.
One critique that comes up is American Idol is kind of a fast track to success, and when do these kids get to experience real hardcore dues paying? And I always chuckle when I hear that, because you've plopped them down into the most hyper-intensive learning experience that you could possibly have. They've had the biggest crash course in dues paying that you can get.
When we go from the road to Hollywood Week, and at Hollywood Week, we call it Hell Week for a reason. It's a real boot camp.
Patrick is definitely the first point of contact. He'll tell you where to go, or he'll put you in your place. You know, he'll tell you whatever.
I'm gonna miss yelling at contestants, for sure. It's one of my favorite things to do.
This show is like a school for the entertainment business.
You say to Scotty McCreary, you hold your mic funny when you sing. He doesn't know he's doing it until he watches it back. And how many people get to watch themselves back on national television?
I am forever tormented by which camera's on. They'd always yell at me. They'd be like, the red light, the red light.
Like, I remember being on the show and Bird, who was the vocal coach, saying, you have to learn how to sing for radio. I was like, what does that mean?
Well, I don't hold the microphone sideways anymore like I used to on season 10. I learned that. Sound guys didn't like that. And it looked goofy.
A lot of them didn't know how to use camera, so we would teach them about connecting and making the people at home think that you're looking right at them.
The fact that it was boot camp, the fact that it was taking in a lot of information, I learned probably most of what I know about singing live on television from being on Idol.
Music isn't actually about selling a song or a download. It's selling a relationship with an artist.
Early on, the shows were more about the story of finding the people and the whole show going on the road. Then, season 4, there was a more conscious decision to tell more of that person's stories.
I auditioned for the big round with, like, thousands of people. And with each little round that they had, they kind of asked more questions. And where are you from? What do you do? Like, what do your parents do? And I was like, well, we kind of live on a farm. We have cattle. Immediately, it was like, oh, farm girl from Oklahoma. Like, we like this.
Meet farm girl Carrie Underwood. She's more used to feeding the cattle with her father than singing on stage. It's her first trip ever to the big city, and she was a little confused.
Well, a lot of people take pictures of, like, the sidewalk, the stars, the sign, and you take pictures of the trees. Any of the stars? Have you seen stars?
It's been pretty cloudy.
I mean, celebrity.
Oh, okay. No, just you.
Oh, well. Hopefully it gets better.
And when the votes came in, she just won every single week.
The winner of American Idol 2005 is Carrie Underwood!
Carrie Underwood was always going to be the American Idol.
Idol was made for people like me that just needed a door.
Well, I ain't got time to catch no fast train.
I was working as a service advisor for a dealership. I knew nothing about cars. I had been writing songs for 10 years at that point, and I just needed people to believe in that, and I used you guys as an audition for record labels. I can't get to the record label. They're probably paying attention to this.
Without a show like Idol, some of us wouldn't have been able to make it into the industry because of all the BS. I went on to a TV show where I could go straight to the people and say, screw the business people. I want to go to the people who are going to consume the music in the first place. And it worked.
I don't think it's a music show. I think it's a show about transformation. It's a show that tells stories about sort of people and their dreams. You don't watch it for the music. You watch it because of those kids.
Chris Allen!
There's always that tension between making a television show versus being obsessed with finding that pop star. And that's part of fine balance, because to validate the premise, you need to find the pop star. But if you don't deliver an entertainment show, you don't have an audience.
The underdog, the dark horse, comes back and wins the nation over. How does it feel?
It feels good, man, but Adam just
Chris,
Adam
more
deserves
enthusiasm.
Even if you win, it doesn't mean your career is set in stone. It's not gonna fall in your lap.
Being an artist is about expressing your own thing.
What are you expecting for the rest of the day, Adam?
Lots of this. Being an entertainer and a business person is a different side of things. And being on the show was a great way to sort of trial and error what entertainment versus being an artist was.
American Idol does not entitle you to a career. It entitles you to an opportunity to have one.
It's about the work ethic and what these people are doing that you don't see.
You know, it's a very high-risk business, the music business, but you've got to keep proving yourself over and over and over again, and that's true for the biggest superstars in the world, as it is for someone coming off American Idol.
You don't become a star just merely by appearing on a reality show. The critical thing from the beginning, find your hit song.
The headlight has come a long way.
This show that you do, I mean, it seems to gain momentum with each season. Do you ever have these kind of night before the premiere nightmares that this will be the year it tanks?
The show became number one every single year. It became so mainstream. It changed the way the music industry looked at not only discovering talent, but selling talent.
What Motown did and what they were successful at doing in Detroit was industrializing the hit-making process in a way that was really unprecedented. American Idol found a very, very successful way to industrially produce talent. So they knew how to take the talent from its earliest moment, and that talent then became part of the fabric and the landscape of the culture.
When you look at the stats alone, like, I love it when they have those commercials on TV that are like, a bazillion Grammys, a gazillion number ones. Like, it's absolutely, those are real figures, by the way.
You know, there's so many artists have gone on to have huge success. Very high strike rate compared to anything else in the music business.
My first album sold 3 million copies. This stuff is like, it only happens in your wildest dreams.
11 songs on the Billboard chart, beating Madonna, Coldplay. To be mentioned, even in a passing breath, with acts like that who have built such a career, like, that's insane.
It was an extraordinary group effort to put all the pieces together around that person so they could try and chase real commercial success in the real world.
The recording contract became such a valuable prize. We went to the best writers as if we were doing Whitney Houston.
Lady Gaga wrote a song and I recorded it with her, and it was crazy being in the studio on that level for my first album working with these people. I was like, oh. But it definitely gave me a sense of confidence because I knew I was working with the best of the best.
I have never seen a television program be as successful and have the social impact that American Idol did.
This is Idol Gives Back.
We had huge success, and over the first two Idol Gives Back, we raised over $187 million.
For everyone who's donated, if you can afford it, thank you very much indeed.
I think one of the biggest challenges for me was how could we change and improve the show.
This is American Idol.
We had to find ways to be smart about creating the show and making it still interesting and fun for people to watch. I think you begin to realize, even the most hardened musicians, that the show is a platform.
Please say hello to Stevie Wonder.
There was a long list of established artists that wanted to come on the show to promote their record release because it was the biggest audience they could find anywhere.
She's taken a quick break from her sold-out tour to perform her new single, Here For You. Tears Always Win. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Alicia Keys.
Mike Darnell kept throwing more money at it and saying, we need more moving lights and we need more of this, more of that. Anything that you might see on the Grammys or some of the other big musical specials.
And that's when you started to see, hey, is that Katy Perry? Hey, is that Gaga?
Please welcome back the unstoppable icon, Beyoncé.
I still remember the day Beyoncé called me over off camera, off mic, and was like, oh boy, I just love you.
How you doing?
I'm great.
So nice.
Scotty boy, that's my boy.
Yeah, Beyonce, that's right, that's cool.
Queen was asked to perform on the finale, and I performed with them, and it just connected. People loved it, and we turned it into a world tour.
The guests that we could pull in, the mentors who'd come and do the show, were testament to the fact that this was a behemoth.
In the, you know, 2000s, there was Idol, and literally everything else. I think at one point the closest show was 35% below Idol's numbers, which is insane. There's just been nothing like it since.
You're on a show that's a competition. You're competing against other kids. The real world flashes up. There's you, and there's Gaga, Beyonce, Rihanna. Can you compete?
We've always tried to be a little wary about how big it gets, where the focus is. Is the focus on the kids? Is the focus on the judges? It should always, and certainly, you know, I've made a lot of mistakes about this. It should always, in truth, be about the talent. Don't worry too much about the fireworks and everything else.
No matter what stage you have, no matter how big it became, the 15 or 20 feet between the contestant and the judge, that performance and that critique, that's where the show was made.
It was an American Idol frenzy Tuesday afternoon. The new and fourth judge arrived for her first day on the job.
So the judging panel grew. We added Kara into the mix.
When people talk about the original panel, the first person they go to is Simon. And I don't think that's really fair. You should also look at what Paula brought to the panel.
Can I give you a hug?
And that was a huge, huge amount of heart.
There has been a huge shakeup at American Idol this morning. Paula Abdul, one of the judges, as you know, is leaving the show.
Paula's leaving was a shock to a lot of us.
When you start dismantling the winning team, all bets are off.
Please say hi to your new judge at American Idol, Ellen DeGeneres.
You're unique. I think you have a unique quality that you should embrace. You're hiding inside and scared to death, and you got to let go of that because those nerves are going to kill you.
Ellen brought a lot of the same heart that Paula had, but I think deep down inside, she didn't really enjoy the part where she had to criticize them.
Why it worked in the early days was it was like the lunatics had taken over the asylum. Then after a time, as it gets more and more successful, then more and more people come along with more and more opinions, and then it starts feeling fun, and that's, you know, when I knew it was time to go.
Simon Cowell will step down as a judge on Fox's American Idol at the end of this season.
I remember him telling me in his dressing room one day, I think this is it. I think I'm gonna, you know, this is my last season.
On his last night of American Idol, Simon Cowell.
So much of the show was about him and his relationship with the contestants and with the fellow judges and with the audience.
I was proud to have been a part of, you know, a kind of a revolution in a way of reality and music, and I knew it was never going to be like that again.
Oh, you know, I didn't think I was going to be this emotional, but I genuinely am. It's been a blast. Thank you.
Are we going to be able to continue without Simon Cowell? Without him, what would happen to our show?
Man We Love to Hate is leaving American Idol. Simon Cowell has announced that this will be his last season on the hit show.
When Simon decided to go, all of us weren't quite sure what that meant for the tone of the show, who was the right person to come into the show, what would the chemistry be like.
We were looking for people who had credibility and had a lot of expertise that they could bring to our contestants.
I'm not an A&R person like Randy or Simon. For me, being an artist and being a performer, I just had a different lens to look at the contestants through.
I just think you're really, really special, you know, which is what an artist is.
And then it was, how do we make another change that would highlight all the assets that Jennifer has?
How can we find somebody who's going to be unpredictable and who's going to surprise and who's going to maybe shock?
Hot, humid, and happening.
Absolutely.
Yeah, just like your daughter.
And that's how we got to Steven Tyler.
Dan!
Steven had never watched the show. He had no idea what was going on that first day. So you got some of that naivety and that freshness back.
I didn't know where we were, what was going to happen, or what was going on that day.
He had such a tender, affectionate spirit, coupled with this completely wicked, massively inappropriate sense of humor.
I love the skirt.
Just the right amount showing. That's nice.
It was the first time we'd bleeped the judges.
Hellfire, save matches, duck and see what hatches.
Steven Tyler's great. He's a nutcase. You never know what he's going to say.
I never wanted to discourage anyone. I don't know where I'd be if it wasn't for a few
words of encouragement.
We did great. I mean, Simon left and our ratings barely changed. That was an important moment for American Idol.
The show got a very different tone. It became a much warmer show, a much more nurturing show.
I don't know that The Voice is really up to par with what we're doing this year, but, you know, you have all those other things going for you.
I still don't like that idea of judging people because I had been judged my whole career.
Oh, God. It lost some of its edge. And then, of course, they're big superstars, and so the focus started to turn more to them and away from the contestants.
I've sung for the famous judges before, but they weren't people that I've looked up to since I was, like, 4 years old, so I'm like...
Really?
Sorry.
It's tough and it's challenging, and there's been many changes, and some we got right and some we didn't get right.
Working with Mariah and Nikki was exceptionally challenging.
We actually got to the first show, and within 2 hours, they were screaming at each other.
And nothing would stop them once they got going, which I don't think the public enjoyed. We certainly didn't.
I think I was done, you know what I mean?
We've gotten a little nicer.
How you doing, Adam?
Good, wasn't really that nervous right up until now.
I get it.
I'd done a lot of these talent shows when I was very young in Australia as a contestant. I did 4 different shows. I'm so lost without you, I know you were right, believing me so. I've always felt an affinity for this kind of environment.
You've got the ability to play the guitar and sing. 40 points from me.
40 from Rob, that's 79 for you, Keith.
I really wanted to be able to be a part of that, particularly being on the other side of the desk this time.
About a year ago, we had a really honest discussion with the network. They were very much on board for having it come back, but we have to make it in a way that's a lot more cost-effective. You can't do that and preserve what the show is. And at that point, you're better off going out with our heads high. You know, you want to leave the party when it's still going.
Her story is the story of American Idol. That a man can be kind and a father could
stay. I think this show did more to help relations between Britain and America than anything in the last 200 years. That's one answer. Second answer.
If you go way back to the year 2000 and the reasons for creating American Idol, I was kind of intrigued to see what the public would say and what they want and what they believe in. Here we are 15 seasons later. I think they get it right more than the industry does.
It showed the TV industry that you can trust your audience.
You're either going to make other competitors get better or you're going to make them want to quit.
It is a trendsetter. We can see that because of all the shows that have come in its wake.
Not to toot our own horn, but 15 years ago, we saw where the music industry is now.
Hey, what's this? Is this on film?
Yeah. It's been an amazing experience to watch this show grow from just this little summer series to the phenomenon that it became.
Yeah, yeah, good.
There is an incredible tightness to this crew. We've done this show for 15 years.
Welcome back to the farewell season.
Thank you so much. It's not coworkers, it's our family. It's the Idol family.
I get filled with emotion because I know how hard I worked prior to American Idol, and American Idol was the opportunity that opened the door for all of my dreams to come true.
I was 23 when I met him.
How old are you now?
37.
At the time, American Idol was my best shot, and they gave me a blast off.
And all I remember is your back.
It's so hard to get into this industry. It's so hard, and it's more about who you know. Well, we just happened to know Idol was holding auditions.
I traveled 1,500 miles to see you.
Kelly and Piece by Piece. Everyone in America was hanging on those same exact notes.
I begged you to want me, but you didn't want to.
Her story is the story of American Idol.
The Girl Next Door becoming one of the most successful people in our industry today. It's the story that everyone wants to have when they come on American Idol.
6 years old, and you know, he never walks away. He never asks for money. He takes care of me, cause he loves me. Piece by piece, he restored my faith that a man can be kind and a father could stay.
At the time, I had no idea that this would happen, you know, my career would happen, and you hope for that, and you expect that in the back of your mind, but I just had no idea.
Piece by piece, he'll restore my faith. Sorry. That a man can be kind, and a father should be, and a father should be great.
American Idol leaves an inheritance of hope, the American dream. And the dream is still alive because we've been able to witness it over and over and over again.
It's such an amazing format. I think that some way, in some different incarnation, it'll be back.
One of the few things that I find exciting about this chapter coming to an end is that there's a new chapter to begin. And I do believe there's an opportunity to do things differently and see what a revamped next generation American Idol might look like.